in particular for the Bunny Bounce, which will happen on March 30th, that Saturday between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. It's an opportunity when St. Joe at the Y will drop thousands of little rubber bouncy balls from the walking track at the Jackson Lehman YMCA down onto the gym floor. But even more than that, it's an opportunity to be a witness of the light and love of Jesus Christ. So mark those calendars to invite friends and neighbors and to yourself. Show up and serve and be a witness on that week in which we remember Christ's witness of God's mercy and hope for all people. As we prepare for Easter, also be aware that one thing churches often do is give folks the opportunity to buy lilies and tulips as an act of celebration so that on Easter Sunday, the sanctuary and other worship spaces can be decorated. If you'd be interested in doing that, know you can buy a tulip or a lily at your place of worship at the Mission Center desk. At St. Joe at the Y, that's at the back of the space of worship, and at St. Joe UMC, that is in the main hall. Check in there and learn more. Of course, there are other ways we're preparing for the season ahead and even for the celebration of Easter. And one of them week by week is to just pray. This week at St. Joe UMC, you can meet on Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. for a time of prayer. I hope to see you there. There are other things going on in the life of the church. A week from tomorrow, next Monday, March 11th, the Maxine Coleman Circle, which is a group of women here at St. Joe UMC, will be having an event open to all women, girls, ladies everywhere from St. Joe UMC, St. Joe at the Y, and our community. They'll have a special guest speaker, and their theme will be food, fellowship, and faith. What a perfect theme there for a church that is faithful, fearless, and fruitful. Finally, tomorrow night, there will be an Endowment Church conference in the worship center. Don't listen to what the guy in the next part of the video says. It'll be in the worship center at 6:30 p.m. That's an official and legal meeting of our church to affirm changes that have been made to that document, but I won't waste your time telling you any more. Here's a little bit more about all of that.
There are many ways the people of St. Joe UMC and St. Joe at the Y live out their faithful, fearless, and fruitful values as they live outward in their vision of being for the fort. Sharing our story, service, worship, and study of the person and work of Jesus Christ together all take their place, and fearless, sacrificial giving cannot be overlooked. Most of the time, most of us don't consider the financial resources required to live out our vision. There's more to that than meets the eye. You could think of the funding of ministry as coming from three primary areas. First, the annual budget. Salaries, building maintenance, and most ministry-related costs, ranging from pizza for the youth group all the way to paper for the bulletins and so much more, are drawn from this. And most people support the annual budget by giving from a percentage of their earned income. It's a little bit different for everybody. There's a second area of ministry known as a capital campaign. A capital campaign is not an ongoing funding source, but rather typically not more than 3 years in duration. A capital campaign can occur when a church determines that there are ministry needs that need to be addressed related to the long-term vision of the church. Often, when a capital campaign occurs, most people will give to support this above and beyond their annual giving. Some people will give from earned income, but it's very common during capital campaigns for folks to give gifts of stock, from their savings, or even from IRA distributions. Again, it's a midterm ask for a specific project or set of projects that doesn't last forever. The final way that the ministry of the church is funded is through the church's endowment. The endowment is a fund invested potentially in a range of options, including savings accounts, CDs, mutual funds, and stocks. The endowment fund grows by increasing those investments and by donations, which typically occur through planned giving, or, in other words, when people leave a behest to the church from their estate, their will, or through the payout of a life insurance policy or annuity. The endowment fund is a way that some people choose to leave a legacy of ministry that will bear the gospel long after their days of serving and writing checks are over, perhaps even for decades and longer after their death. In a few weeks, on March 4th at 6:30 p.m. in the sanctuary, St. Joe UMC will hold a church conference to ratify a new endowment charter. These are the legal rules by which our endowment operates. All attendees and members are encouraged to attend, and even more, to offer their opinions and support for this vital means of funding for the future. Any questions? Just reach out to the endowment chair, John Painter. He attends the classic worship, or Pastor Glenn. And remember, no matter how you give, or live out your service to be faithful, fearless, and fruitful, we'll all be for the fort. St. Joe UMC and St. Joe at the Y.
Good morning. It's nice to see the sun shining. Would you please all stand as you're able and join me in our call to worship? Lenten travelers, why are you here? We gather to do the work of worship. Lenten travelers, what happens when we gather to worship? We listen and proclaim. We sing and pray. We repent and encourage. Lenten travelers, how do we do the work of worship? We bring all that we are to be present to God and one another. Lenten travelers, what work does God do in worship? God raises us up so that we can delight in life together with God and one another. Lenten travelers, come, let us worship God together. Come, let us worship God together. Amen. Let us continue to worship together by singing our opening hymn, Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
Oh,
Please join me as we affirm our faith through our prayer of confession. With hearts of sorrow, we come before you, O God, to confess what you already know. We have failed to keep your laws. Again and again, we have followed our own selfish will, rather than your holy and life-giving will for our lives. We have twisted your decrees and institutions to suit our preconceptions and interests, rather than your own. Forgive us, O God, and cleanse us from hidden faults, that the words of our mouths and the meditation of all our hearts may be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. And now words of assurance. God shows steadfast love and blesses to the thousandth generation those who follow God's ways. In love, God sent Jesus to bless and redeem God's people. God forgives us our sins and restores us to new life. Let us rejoice in God's mercy. May be seated.
This last week, an incredible event occurred. It was a celebration of the more than 250 staff at Jackson Lehman YMCA. And yes, St. Joe at the Y led the way in that, but it wouldn't have been possible for not all of you who filled out thank you notes for those staff people, for not all of you who made dishes to care, to show your love. I hate to tell you this, but there have been witnesses from time to time who said they don't get it. St. Joe will never buy in to serving people and caring and investing in that ministry at the Y. They won't do it. They don't get it. They can't get it. They don't care. But guess what? You proved them wrong. Glory to God. Amen. Yes. Glory to God. There was a woman who was on staff, and she came in to see the lunch that was put out by our folks. And there was a vegan stew. May not be for you, but she saw that vegan stew, and she said, who told them? Who told them that that's the only thing I could have? And I said, lady, I don't know what you're talking about. But we are a church that recognizes, and of course, Pastor Ashley planned it well, that when the table's set, and we want everybody to know that they are welcome at it. And when we set a table like that at St. Joe and St. Joe at the Y, we know that that table is an offering, not just to the people we share it with, but one that's pleasing to God. With that in our mind and heart, I want to invite the ushers to come at this time and to receive God's tithes and offerings that we might worship yet again.
Let's pray. Oh God, we turn our hearts to you, and we know that when you look to us, when you draw to us, our hearts are laid open, for there is nothing hidden from you. And you know that we long, O God, in the midst of every other temptation, still to be nearer to you. What we have found is that you draw near to us, that you come near to us even in the moments we come near to one another. God, we celebrate this week that we find ourselves around your table, a meal given by Jesus for us and all people. And we celebrate that this week we have joined in that table with people like Dan and Judy Rickert. We continue to lift them to you. We celebrate that in this week you have been near and given hope to those who await surgery and to those who recover from it, to those who are isolated at home watching online, and to those of us who have returned from distant journeys. Oh God, we find ourselves drawn nearer to you and nearer to one another. We celebrate that you were with the Moreland family last night, that you drew near as Ada found her elbow broken, and as her dad, Tyler, and her mom, Ashley, spent the night with her. Oh God, draw near this family and bring Ada healing in this day. Bring us all continuing to be closer together and closer to you until one day we finally sit at the table you have prepared for all people, until one day we see friends we have not seen for years, and those who have been gone but a time. Be with us until we feast at that heavenly banquet, until all that we have, all that we are, all that we have given this day becomes an offering used for the mission of your love. Meet us today, O God, and draw near to us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing for the reading of the Gospel from John chapter 2.
Verse 13 through 22, it was nearly time for the Jewish Passover, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple those who were selling cattle, sheep, and doves, as well as those involved in exchanging currency. They were all sitting there. He made a whip from ropes, and he chased them all out of the temple, including the cattle and the sheep. He scattered the coins and overturned the tables of those who exchanged currency. He said to the dove sellers, "Get those things out of here. Don't make my Father's house a place of business." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Passion for your house consumes me." Then the Jewish leaders asked him, "By what authority are you doing these things? What miraculous sign will you show us?" Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jewish leaders replied, "It took 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But the temple Jesus was talking about was his body, and he was raised from the dead. His disciples remembered what he had said, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
And of course, at this time, before we pray, I Don't want to neglect to dismiss kids to kids' church. Miss Taya is back in the narthex. Let's pray. Oh God, yes, we offer ourselves and our hearts to you. Holy Spirit, in this time, won't you prepare them? Won't you evaluate us and send us? We are ready. We are willing. Oh God, won't you make us able? By your Spirit through this song, and through the word proclaimed and the meal that is given, send us. Send us, Lord, for we love you. Amen. Well, I don't know if you've ever been to Loudonville, Ohio, but it's a really happening town. It's right near the Mohican State Park, where we had gone on a summer family vacation last summer. Down in Loudonville, Ohio, there's an old opera house, and they have kind of refurbished the place to make it a movie theater, and it's our kind of movie theater for my family, because when we were there, we saw we could watch a newly released installment of the Indiana Jones film series, the last one with Harrison Ford in it, for only $4 a person. Now, I'm a fan of Indiana Jones. Can I get an amen? Amen. Yeah. But even more, as a father to four children, I'm a fan of $4 movie tickets because it's the only way we're going to see a movie in a theater. And $1 snacks was even better. We went to this opera house that had been transformed to be a movie theater. And we got there early to make sure we got our spaces. And we found our spot and staked it out, almost no one else there. And in behind us came a couple women, a couple old ladies who sat down right behind me. And after a couple minutes, I heard one say to the other, "Oh, this happens to me at church all the time. I'm stuck behind a guy with a big head." I gave it a couple seconds, and I turned around, and I said, "Ma'am, would you like me to move?" She said, "Oh, no, I wasn't talking about you." I gave her a little bit more ribbing about the whole situation, and we both agreed that I would slouch for the next 2.5 hours so that she could see whatever Harrison Ford was doing on the screen more fully. My kids, who could hear the conversation, of course, could hardly contain themselves. We got into the car, I relayed the story to my wife, and I said to Amy, I said, "I don't have a big head, do I?" She rubbed my shoulder. She said, "Oh, Glenn, I think you have a nice head." She alone knew that the Stetson cowboy hat in my closet is the largest quote-unquote normal size they sell. She alone knew, but we all know how uncomfortable it is to be evaluated by our outer appearance. And so we do find a comfort in the promise that God does not look at outward appearance. But we tremble at the word of the Lord, which comes to us in all of Scripture and which assures us that though God does not look at outward appearance, the Lord looks at the heart. And that evaluation doesn't feel all that comfortable either. In the text before us today, we have Jesus drawing near to Jerusalem. And when he says there is an evaluation of both hearts and outward appearances as well. John chapter 2, beginning at verse 13, tells us it was nearly the time for the Jewish Passover. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple those who were selling cattle, sheep, and doves, as well as those involved in exchanging currency, sitting there. He made a whip from ropes and chased them all from the temple. There's another little threat running through here, whip. Yeah, they didn't think you'd laugh at that at the Y either. And, come on, whip and temple? Is this thing on? Beth, can you hear me? There's a, check. The sale on garden hoses and sprinklers on aisle 9. Okay, it's on. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah. Whipping cords, he chases them out of the temple, including the cattle and the sheep. He scatters the coins, he overturns the tables of those who exchange the currency, and he says to the dove sellers, "Get those out of here. Don't make my Father's house a place of business." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Passion for your house consumes me." Now, to understand fully what's happening here, we have to think about the temple that Jesus has drawn near. It's not a temple of doom at all. In fact, it's the temple of Jerusalem. And we have a depiction of that this morning that can help us think about that for those of you who enjoy your sermon pictures. This is a temple that is not the first temple that is constructed. This artistic rendering depicts what is known as the second temple. The first temple had been built by 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. But this second temple had been reconstructed after the destruction of the first. In 587 BC, the Babylonians had conquered Israel and Palestine. They had destroyed Jerusalem and carried the stones of the temple away, not leaving one on another. About 70 or 80 years later, a second temple was constructed. It would stand for a long time, but as things that exist over a long period of time, it would need refurbishment and eventually a full rebuild. And by 50 years before the birth of Jesus, a guy by the name of Herod the Great would rise to power, climbing the slippery ancient political pole to collude with Romans and with the Roman Empire so that he could rule the land of what today we know as Israel and Palestine and Syria. When Herod did this, he was ruthless, but he was also a tactical politician, and he understood that monuments and public works would win the people to his side, so the temple was reconstructed with glory and grandeur. And you can see it was constructed up and above and over the city of Old Jerusalem, high above the city, right next to it, and only behind that rising smoke from the temple in the picture being the Antonia Fortress, that place of Roman power and might also looming over the city. There they were, Herod's temple and the source of his power, hand in hand, right next to each other, over the city. If you would come to visit and worship at this temple, and anyone could, and many people did, you could, even not being a Jewish person, come and worship. You could enter by the outer court for non-Jews, male and female, and for Jewish men and women, they could go into the second court to worship there. Only Jewish men could enter the temple proper, and then only a select few Jewish men called priests could go into that holiest of places. When you would come to worship, you would do so in the way the law of Moses had prescribed. You would come and offer a dove or a pigeon. You would offer a sheep or a goat if you could afford to, or on some occasions even cattle offered as sacrifices, burnt offerings to God. If any of you have ever traveled with doves or pigeons before, though, you know that they're really a hassle to get stuck into your overhead compartment. And this was true in the old days as well. And so many people, when they would come to worship in Jerusalem, would come and purchase the doves, the pigeons, the sheep, the goat, the cattle required, as their means could afford, even at the temple and its area. There was a business, a cottage industry that grew up to meet the needs of the faithful. Capitalism flourished around the temple. Of course, though, it wasn't just meeting the needs of the faithful. It very quickly became abusing the faithful, taking advantage of their need to buy the doves, the sheep, the goats, the pigeons, the cattle. Exorbitant rates were charged. And because people were coming all over, money needed to be exchanged. And that money was not just worth something because Caesar's face was on it. That money would be weighed out by its very weight, literally, to make sure that it maintained its value. And as it was changed, often coins would be shaved and the shavings kept. And so not only were the faithful being cheated in their purchase, but cheated in their changing of their money. And Jesus shows up to evaluate. Now, it should be stated, many people, with all of this corruption, all of the corruption around the buying and selling of the animals, all of the corruption that went all the way to Rome and Herod's spiritual power being linked by the temple and the fortress right next to each other, many people had walked away and said, I'm done with it. I'm not doing that. I won't worship God. Their whole communities had gone out to the desert to worship God in those places. People like John the Baptist had gone out to the wilderness to call for repentance and a change. But the thing about Jesus is, isn't this cool? Jesus goes everywhere. And Jesus goes to the temple, a place a whole lot of other people have given up on. He goes to the temple and he evaluates the actions and the hearts. And he ends up turning tables. He ends up determining that not only the action parts of those present have been found wanting, and the folks there are justifiably perplexed. By John chapter 2, they begin to question on what right he did that. I mean, just imagine what it felt like to the good church people of the time for Jesus to take the offering plates and throw them out the door. That's more or less what he did. By John 2:13, then the Jewish leaders asked him, "By what authority are you doing these things? What miraculous signs will you show us?" And Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up." The Jewish leaders replied, "It took Herod 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But the temple Jesus was talking about was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered what he said, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. When we come to this text, we have to remember that there are more or less three purposes in its existence. The first comes from understanding that this same event occurs in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. In three of those Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels, those Gospels that give us a synopsis chronologically of what's happening, the event occurs near the very end. It's given in Matthew, Mark, and Luke as an explanation for why Jesus will die and be crucified. Because when he goes and flips over the tables of the powerful, the people with authority say, "This is no good. He's got to go." So we understand that is one purpose of relaying the story. John's gospel approaches things entirely differently. John's gospel is not concerned with the chronological layout of events. John's gospel is always more concerned with what events mean. And for this reason, John's gospel begins with this story. After all, we're only in John chapter 2. And what John wants to convey is not only what Matthew, Mark, and Luke's gospel want to convey, that this is why Jesus will die. John's gospel from the get-go wants to communicate that Jesus understood that he would die and that he would rise again. "Destroy this temple, and I'll rebuild it in 3 days." Yet the final reason, and this reason runs through all of the Gospels, that we are brought this text in this way, is to be reminded that Jesus is not only meek and gentle, not only the bringer of mercy, but that in him, the God who is the God of Hebrew Scripture also draws near. That's something worth thinking about. That's something worth trembling about if you really do stop and think. After all, that would suggest that the God who creates heaven and earth has come to us in Jesus Christ. It would suggest that the God who evaluates and examines and casts Adam from the garden for their selfishness is now the God who is present to us in Jesus Christ. They would suggest to us that the God who visited 10 plagues upon all the power and might of ancient Egypt, that God's people might be set free, is the same God who visits us in Jesus Christ. Is anybody shaking a little bit yet? That same God visits us in Jesus Christ is the God who led God's people through the wilderness to a holy mountain where the law was given and the command went forth, no man, no woman, no child, no animal but Moses was to set foot on that mountain. For if they did, they would surely die. That same God of Hebrew Scripture is coming present to us in Jesus Christ. That same God from whom Moses passed before Moses, and yet Moses hid his face, for he knew that no one could see the Lord and live. That same God who spoke to Job from the whirlwind now has come to us in Jesus Christ. That same God has come to us in Jesus Christ, and the end of the story tells us that one day that God in Christ will come to us again with hair as white as wool, and robes resplendent like lightning, and feet like burnished brass. That God in Christ draws near to us, and on his thigh is tattooed the title of King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he will examine all the rulers of the earth and implement his justice. That God draws near to the tables of the temple. Whew. In Jesus Christ. And if we stop and consider that, we do tremble. We tremble at the thought that he would visit our table. And upon examination, what would he find? What would he find of our outer appearance? And what would he find of our heart? Though we tremble, we are cheered as well by the thought and comforted that Hebrews verse 18 tells us exactly what is when Jesus comes to our table. When that God of Hebrew scripture draws near. Brothers and sisters, we have confidence that we can enter that holiest place in the temple, the Holy of Holies, not by pigeons and doves, but by means of Jesus' blood, through a new and living way he opened up for us through the curtain which is his body. And we have a great high priest. Therefore, let us draw near with a genuine heart, with the certainty that our faith gives us, since our hearts are sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies are washed with pure water. Let's hold on to our hope without wavering. The one who made the promises is reliable. The God who draws near to us in Christ Jesus is, yes, indeed, the God of Hebrew scriptures, but he is also the God who in Christ speaks a yes to us, a yes of love, a yes by which he not only comes to our table and certainly doesn't flip it over, but instead lays his own body upon it for us. A God who comes to our table and in Christ Jesus sits down with us. And in so doing, opens not only the doors of the temple, but the doorway of heaven. But we still tremble, for we fear the examination of our heart. We fear that the transformation that it leads to is painful. I remember more than a decade ago, I visited a woman who was preparing for a heart replacement, heart transplant. She was only about 50 years old, but her heart was failing through no fault of her own. And she knew that the day was coming soon. In fact, it was only days away that if she did not have the replacement, she would not live. And she trembled. She trembled because if she was to get a new heart, it would come from someone who didn't give it exactly willingly, though they had signed the back of their driver's license. It would have to be a gift. She trembled because if she received the heart, the road to recovery would be long and painful and arduous and difficult, maybe more than she could bear, more than she could conceive of. She trembled at the prospect of a new heart, and she trembled as well, for if the heart did not come or if the surgery failed, she would stand before the judgment seat and face a different kind of examination. And everyone, if they're honest, will say that when we contemplate that, standing before God in that way, we tremble. We tremble. But we pray. We just pray. And as we prayed, we trusted that the God who would draw close to examine the heart was a God who in Jesus Christ was good, who was faithful, who is just. He knew these things because he had given himself for us. He had sat at our table when perhaps it should have been flipped. He had set a meal for us. There was hope. She did, a few days later, get her heart transplant. And it came from a young man who died in a car accident. And so far as I know, she lives well to this day with a new heart, learning to live with a new heart. And aren't we all? What can we do? As we consider God drawing near to us in Christ in the examination of our appearance and our heart, but just pray. And so I ask you now to close your eyes and bow your heads as I guide you through a daily examine, a history in the church, and something you can Google and look up to include in your daily prayer practices. Let's pause for a moment as we examine the week behind us, the day that is today, and the week ahead. Let us begin with relishing the moments that went well and the gifts you had for this day. Let's pause in prayer and relish the moments that went well and the gifts you had for this day. Now we request the Holy Spirit to lead us in the review that is to come. Simply talk to God and say, God, show me. Examine my heart. And now we review this day, the week behind, and the week ahead. We pause to review. Having relished our moments, requested the Spirit, reviewed the day, we now repent of the mistakes and failures we find as we examine our hearts. Oh, hear the good news. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. This proves God's love to us. In the name of Christ, we are forgiven. And now that we have relished, requested, reviewed, and repented, let us now resolve in a concrete way to live with new hearts, to live well tomorrow in the victory of Jesus Christ. Amen. We examine our hearts and we tremble as the God of all creation draws near to us in Jesus Christ, and we are warmed to know that as he does and we see our very fault, that he sits down at our table with us. He prepares one for us. And we turn our hearts to him and the meal he has given. Please join me in the liturgy of communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to death and evil, your love remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare for the joy of the Easter feast that, renewed by word and sacraments, and fervent in prayer and works of justice and mercy, that we might come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who love you. And so, with all the people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent to the fullness of time to redeem the world. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant and being born in our likeness. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He took upon himself our sin and death and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, and he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let's pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, both now and forever. Amen and amen. This morning, I'm going to ask Pastor Ron, would you be so kind as to assist me? And Karen, right back there, would you be willing to assist me as well? And I would appreciate if I need one more person that I didn't arrange for ahead of time. And so now everybody sweats as I wonder, Ms. Myers, would you be so kind as to assist also? In the United Methodist Church, of which St. Joe UMC is a part, all people are welcome at the table of the Lord if they believe Jesus Christ to be the Lord of their life and they have evaluated their heart and confessed their sin to him. Pastor Ron, would you start this for the choir, please? If you are here this morning and you have a pulse, can I get an amen?
Amen?
Okay, if your neighbor didn't say amen, just reach over and tap their wrist and make sure everything's... If you're here and you have a pulse, and Jesus is the Lord of your life, and you have examined your heart with him, you are welcome at his table. We invite you to come. Pastor Ron, here's the bread for you. Well, here, I'll give you this. There you go. I will bring these ladies down here. Melanie? Get my act together. You know, this is my third service. Ron, do you remember, do we have them start at the back?
We'll have them start at the back.
We're going to start at the back. So we'll ask folks in the back to come forward and receive the meal Jesus has given. thing about that. When I was a small child, I know you're thinking, Glenn, you're still a kid. When I was a small child, I heard the church sing that song, and a weird thing happened. I believed it. Every now and then, Jesus draws near, and just when I think he's fixing to flip my table, he sits down with me, and I still can't quite believe that. You are witnesses of that victory, of not only the temple being opened, but the kingdom of heaven itself. May you go in the peace and power of the God of all scripture who draws near in Jesus Christ. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to be God's witnesses. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.